Rightio, so thank you for coming. It's queer to see you, me. Let's start with a little bit of genealogy. Could say history, but genealogy is much nicer, isn't it? We all read Foucault. All right. So if we think about queer theory and where to locate that in contemporary philosophy or contemporary social theory, critical theory, cultural theory, then I think we need to, we can start with Foucault, but we can also start more generally with obviously feminist thinking, feminist philosophy, the emergence of feminism, more specifically the feminist thinking that is following on from second wave feminism. Mm-hmm. I'd like to start with this wonderful quote, which in case of any of you hadn't noticed and wouldn't have thought it is bleedingly obvious, but I mean, it is symptomatic that somebody like Rita Gross, feminist thinker in religion, needs to actually state explicitly that women really do inhabit the human realm and are not other, not a separate species. And that is, if you remember, in second wave feminism, the whole one of the whole focus points is the question of the woman as the other, the woman as the zero marked to the marked, privileged human, which is the male, you know, the man, the woman that is the inferior default, right? So if we look, move on from that, when we look at feminist methodology, then we could say from second wave feminist thinking and feminism looks at mechanisms of how our thinking and organization of culture and society has been done in order to privilege male voices. We could call that androcentrism, with a nice complicated word. Now, Greek anea andros means man, male, and like them ancient Greeks, it also means human, although they have another term for human, that's anthropos. But it, Greek text, anea can also mean human, like in English, yeah? Man, very often until recently, was also used to just mean human. Andro means man, male, male centrism, androcentrism. And in that sense, feminist thought exposes the problems with generic masculinity, with the generic masculine. And the generic masculine means the center of the discourse. That what is the default. That what is always the assumed. When you don't know anything about a person and power, you think of male. What's the stereotyping that things having to do with power, strength, dominance, are associated male and masculine traits, whereas submission, weakness, peacefulness are stereotypically female traits. And further, feminist thinking problematizes Eurocentrism, especially with the third wave of feminism that comes from the 1990s onwards and the 2000s onwards, and also merges more and more into problematizing modes of colonialist thinking. And we come to this point of intersectionality, where you actually have different segments of identity expressions and how they overlap later, because that becomes very important for queer theory. The rallying cry of 1970s second wave and 1980s second wave feminism is the private is the political. And I think if you need to remember anything about second wave feminism, please remember that. The private is the political. And I like this very, very much because it immediately goes into contemporary, very, very contemporary forms of queer reappropriation of this second wave feminist rallying cry. One of our good Queer in Paradigms Brazilian friends at the Rio conference in 2012 gave a wonderful keynote, starting with the seminal sentence, "Mi culo es público y político." My anus is public and political. So here we have this queer appropriation of what kind of seminal queer, this case gay male sexualities that we would imagine as something very private, done between two people or more if you want, but still in a contingent, a private form, is dared to be vocalized and declared public and politic. In other words, whom we love, whom we share intimacy with, even in the four walls of our private room, this intersects very, very, very pivotally with public and political discourse, societal discourse. The private is the political. So this is why women's bodies rights, abortion, and human bodies rights, male circumcision, you know, anything. All these things where there's a taboo and it is pushed into the private and swept onto the carpet. This already is a form of a political and public decision. Yeah. So the silencing of practices and performances is already political and private. And this is why, and this is where very strongly feminist, second wave feminism connects us to queer theory. If we go on then for queer theory, merging with post-Marxist deconstruction and with Foucauldian stuff, emerges in the 1990s, we find for the first time, as you know, Teresa de Loretis uses word queer in that technical sense for the first time. Later she reverts back to lesbian theory. She doesn't really like it anymore, so she births something, then she disavows it. And people like Judith Butler and Eve Kosofsky-Sedgwick carry it on as pillars of the 1990s discourses on queer theory. And I always use the seminal, description of what we actually looking at in queer theory by Eve Kosofsky-Sedgwick. And what we're looking at here is basically the open mesh of possibilities, gaps, overlaps. It's already, intersectionality is already there in 1993. Kosevsky loves that, overlaps, dissonances and resonances, lapses and excesses of meaning, when constituent elements of anyone's gender, anyone's sexuality, aren't made or can't, simply can't be made to signify monolithically. Wow, that's a sentence. So what does it mean in simple words? Well, I'm not sure it means something in simple words, but I can try to point to the most important thing. What does it mean? It cannot made to be or cannot made to be or can or isn't made to signify monolithically. In other words, if the complexity, the hybridity, the messiness, the muddiness of our gender identity and performance, of our sexuality, identity, performance, and activities, isn't simply cut out black and white. Isn't restricted to binaries, isn't restricted to male and female, isn't, can't be made to fit into the pigeonholes of male or female and heterosexual, homosexual, or maybe in between something that nobody understands, bisexuality, some people don't believe it exists, it does, but you know. You know. No, what this is what it happens. Queer theory is actually what happens when we simply throw these concepts around gender and sexuality up in the air and we hold our hands up and we say, well, screw that. It ain't that simple. And that's what means signify monolithically. I've spoken some years ago, therefore, etymologizing about queers as ricochets, connecting it to the German word queer, which means oblique, against the expected direction. And a Querschläger in German is a ricochet. It is a missile that instead of going where it aims to go, it goes like this. Yeah? And in that sense, queer subjects, people who perform queerness, are ricochets to the hegemonic binary discourses on gender and sexuality. In German, we also have this expression Querköpfe, which means, Köpfe means heads. So people who are who think against the stream, against the expectations. It can also have a negative connotation sometimes. It's a lot more like querulants or people who are just being difficult like me. But I mean, it can also mean something very positive, you know? It's the people who actually innovate, the people who challenge. And that's what queer is about, challenging. So it has, because the nature of queer theory then is in itself challenge of that what is assumed to signify monolithically. Therefore, it has been long established that queer theory, if it means anything, can never entail a single stable intellectual stance. It's not a thing itself. It's not as, okay, we have another pigeonhole, the pigeonhole to de-pigeonhole all other pigeonholes. That would be really silly, you know? You don't like the pigeonholes, let's make a pigeonhole to de-pigeonhole all the other pigeonholes. No. It cannot mean that there is a single intellectual stance, but it in itself needs to utilize a diverse and open conflicting set of interdisciplinary approaches to sex, gender, to what Gifney says, desire, subjectivity, identity, relationality, ethnicity, and norms. Gifney already has an intersectional definition of queer. But what this quote should give you is this idea is queer theory is never a thing. Queer is never a thing. It's always a challenge. It's always a querying. In a sense, queering can be used in the critical theory term for critiquing almost as destructing or deconstructing. So we can then actually ask ourselves afterwards, well, what happens after the deconstructing, after the queering? And that's one of the interests that I have in my research, thinking about, well, after queer theory, after queering. You have already noticed that I use the word queer in very many ways. I use it as a verb to queer, to challenge, to critique, to deconstruct. I use it as an adjective that what goes against the stream of pigeonholed monolithicalities. And there's obviously also queer as a noun for people who say, well, I don't want to identify with anything, so I used to describe queer as a noun to describe my intellectual stance of opposing the pigeonholing. Funny enough, some queer activists then, and that's the insidiousness of our identity impulses, start using queer as, in that sense, as an adjective, as a noun, as a category again in itself. And we have again and again and again questioned that, and we have to challenge that and critique that. Yeah? Because you get in certain activist circles then the good queers and the bad queers. You know, and that is completely, it's preposterous, right? It's against what queer actually sets out to do. I normally like to think about queer in a way, or as I think about mathematical functions. If you remember your A levels in math, there's this kind of functions. So what are functions in mathematics? Well, that they are not a thing. They are not numbers or anything, but they are just something that's just a formula that does something with numbers. So it's not a thing in itself, it's just a process, right? And that's queer. That's queer. So this intellectual instability then means that queer is always connected to subversion of normativities. Foucauldian word of resistance becomes very important in queer theory, resistance, and then broadens out to become applicable and engaged with much wider forms of social justice issues than just the ideas around gender normativities and sexuality normativities, right? Yes, you probably have read somewhere that queer is an appropriation of a term that older generations of gay men especially used to hear shortly before they were beaten up. So that's actually, for a certain populace, a very painful term still. Highly pejorative terms. So, and that's a typical thing. This is the reappropriation of slanderous words, like in black African culture, blacks would reappropriate the word nigger. You see that in black music, for instance, for themselves. You have queer theory derived disability theory calling themselves crip theory. There's disabled people, or very able people, I prefer to say, very able people who take this terrible word crip and make it as a term of empowerment. And so the same is the genealogy of queer. And you will still find in some areas of political discourse that people, that there's a residue of the pejorative of the word queer, especially among the people of 50 plus. Yeah? So it's a gradual development, this appropriation. As I said, it distinguishes itself from, let's say, gay or lesbian or bisexual liberation, and that it is explicitly de-pigeonholing the whole concept of culturally constructed gender. So in this sense, there's a strong element, genealogical element, to cultural constructivism, social constructivism with queer. And it's very interested in how gender and gender stereotypes, gender roles, and so on, are culturally produced. And in that sense, very often the people who do a queer theory rather than lesbian, bisexual, and gay studies are much, much more relaxed about the overlaps and the blurred and the hybrid areas where sexual orientation and gender performance seem to touch or overlap or are a little bit interpolated in each other. for lesbian and gay liberation, especially in the second wave, it was very important to separate gender from sexuality. And in that sense, queer is challenging that again, you know, because at the end of the day, and we see that with the same with the same-sex marriage debate, who got liberated with same-sex marriage, you know, the people who are saying, "Look, we are like you. We just happen to be two men or two women, but for the rest, we are completely like you. You know, we don't challenge gender stereotypes. You know, we're just men or ladies." And so, but for the rest, you know, so and that is what we call in queer theory, we call that homonormativity. It's the form of the lesbian and gay community, which is the majority, that is quite happy to buy into the societal discourse of heteronormativity, including nuclear family, including compulsory monogamy, and all these kind of myths, discursic narratives that produce mainstream heterosexuality. But with the only change of hetero to homo. So we do everything like the heteros, they say. It's just that we happen to be two men or two women. So that is strand of gay activism or lesbian activism, but this is not queer activism. Because as queer activism, we basically say, well, screw that, you know? If I can't be a butch, if I can't be a sissy, if I can't be anything I want, it ain't for me, you know? Why do we have to emulate something that is oppressive for whole society? Because, let's be honest, heteronormativity, so the nuclear family myth and the compulsory monogamy and all this stuff, is not only oppressive for LGBT people, it's oppressive for everybody, right? Because it puts a societal script onto everybody's intimate life and how they negotiate relationships. And there are so many more ways of negotiating and living relationships. So that basically means it is perfectly possible to be an LGBT rights campaigner without being a queer campaigner. And you have that actually. Until recently, Stonewall was a prime example of a very homonormative, terribly homonormative, you know, campaigner for gay rights and lesbian rights a little bit less and so on, you know. And then the least for trans people because, you know, trans people are on the pecking order completely down. Well, just to sum that up, queer is a challenge to the way we are, the way society inscribes a very simple one shoe fits all script onto our multiple hybrid, blurred, messy, muddy bodies and identitarian expressions. And in that sense, it takes away a lot of our agency, a lot of our possibilities, and ultimately it forces every individual, whatever their sexuality or gender, to negotiate the limited space of freedom and agency against this oppressive societal script. Now, queer is that what helps us to challenge that. And on the bottom or on the center, obviously, genealogically, is the idea about gender being binary, that there's only zeros and ones, only willies and foo-foos, and nothing in between, and how that is kinder then negotiated through identity performance and sexual practices. Because, fool you not, the reason that gay men or same-sex or male intragender sexuality has been has a long history of being persecuted and culturally tabooized has less to do with what two willy-bearing people do with each other when nobody else looks. It has more to do with the idea of what somebody who has a willy is supposed to perform in terms of gender identity. So for instance, somebody who has a penis playing a submissive role, being dominated sexually, is culturally constructed as this person, as him disavowing the privilege of masculinity and threatening the privileged masculinity by doing so. So in other words, if you're the real person, the real human, if you're lucky enough to be born as the real human, but you would like to put it, to take it up your bum, then you are disavowing this privilege of power. And you are a threat to everybody else who has a penis, because it gives the horrible possibility that people who have penises can actually also be dominated and be the submissive people. And actually, postmodernly, the statistics of, how much pegging is now enjoyed in heterosexual relationships is actually a good indicator that these kind of stiff ideas about gender roles and sexualities to come along with this are slowly, through feminist and queer discourses, actually softening, pegging. Yes, has to do something with a dildo and something a female partner does to their male partner in a heterosexual relationship. Yeah. Anyway, so again, there's another nice quote from Butler, and this basically says a little bit the same as I was saying about queer not becoming a category yourself. And there's also then the question that Butler already in 1993 asks about the contingency of the term queer. At what point is queer obsolete? And what happens? And that's an interesting thing, because there are some people who talk about the end of queer, and there are some people like myself who are a bit ponderous about what happens to ethics or codes and value production and codes of societal organization after queering. Yeah. So, I mean, one strand in queer theory talks about the death drive, I don't agree with Edelman. In that sense, because it seems to me to Edelman's argument seems to in some sort of perpetuating a stereotype on homosexuality that we had already in the 19th century and the 20th century seems to construct a binary about life affirming versus self-loathing and so on. But there's an important point about it. If we simply deconstruct for deconstructing sake, there's the same sort of criticism that's been flung at Derrida, so where does it leave us in terms of, okay, we blow up the concept of gender, we blow up the concept of normative sexualities. Is there any parameter that we could use in a Kantian term for a universal rule? Is there any way of constructing a post-queer ethics? Well, I made my own suggestions to that, and I'm still thinking about that. And my suggestions are very much around the line of physical integrity and non-restricted, or what I call, some people talk for non-restricted, I call it empowered agency. Well, we might have time to talk about that a little bit later. Anyway, so there's some more. Well, I talked about homonormativity. Now, Kosevsky says we came up with these, and Butler, actually, sorry, Butler, with this idea of minoritizing versus universalizing views, you know. So the thing is, as I can identify as, for instance, a trans woman or a gay man and accept that I'm a minority, or I can say, well, I'm an individual and you all are somewhere on a spectrum and we are all negotiating our subjective identity. So why should I call myself a minority just because I'm at a less appreciated end of one spectrum? Right? So that is more the universalizing thing. So in this sense, I think the people who the least know that they are being liberated by the queering impulse are the people in the center that create the margins, because they normally don't understand how much they are oppressed by the normativities they happen to fulfill and be in the center of. Right? So actually, queer theory can be extremely liberating for white, male, cisgendered, heterosexual, affluent men. Only they need a bit of push to understand that. Anyway, right. Wow, I have so many interesting quotes. Okay, I'm not talking about that now. But it's actually a really interesting quote. So we'll put that on the movie, and you can have a look at it. Just to hammer home, to bring home again and again what I'm saying about queer theory: challenge of heteronormativity, the assumption that anybody in the center of a discourse is assumed to be heterosexual. And this is one of the most things, you know, people saying, well, I don't mind them gays, but do they have to rub it under my nose the whole time, you know? And that's the whole thing, you know, because I'm very, very nicely in the center. And so, we don't burn them on the stakes anymore. So we just don't want to see them because we are so nice and cozy in the center. And what queer does, it explodes the center. No center, no margin. The center creates the margin. You decenter the privilege, and through this explosion, all of a sudden, everybody and nobody is in the center. We become rhizomatic. We become without center and margin, just interrelationally negotiating and connecting our identity and identity expressions. You heard the word cisgenderism, you know. There was the other day, there was an article, I think in Pink News, that somebody called trans activists gender fascists, and I was so angry with that. Not because he's the first idiot that said that, but I use the word gender fascism talking about cis people. These them cis people with them gender fascists, you know. I have to tick a box, male or female. I have to always decide, where do people read me as male or female if I go to a public toilet? And why? It's not important. Why would it be important? Why would it be important if I open a bank account for somebody to know my anatomy or my preferred gender identity or so? It's completely irrelevant. That is what I call gender fascism. It's completely irrelevant. Right? It's only relevant if you still have a residual idea that one gender is better than the other. And that is male suppressing the female. It only plays into what people call heteropatriarchy. And heteropatriarchy functions in a very easy way. It's not complicated to understand heteropatriarchy. It's just two simple logical steps. First step, the human gender lexicon is binary. There's just zeros and ones, zeros being the females and the ones being the males. So that's the first step. You have to accept that. Although we all know that there's intersex people and that there's a whole plethora of trans people, gender non-conforming people, gender rejecting people, you know, all these kind of things. Non-binary people. No. So that's the first step. The second step is the lexicon of human gender is not only binary, but one of them is better than the other. And that's all you need to know about heteropatriarchy. That's how it works. The male is better than female. And there's only male and female, and then male is better than female. And this is why you understand that heteropatriarchy is so extremely hostile to anything, to any expression, be that in sexual practice, be that in gender expression or identity, that is actually challenging these two very simplified steps. This is why heteropatriarchy hates women, because they're inferior to men. It hates gay people, lesbian people, bisexual people, because they challenge the power that is established through dominant versus submissive heterosexual interrelations. And they most of all hate trans people and intersex people because they challenge the very notion of the binary, that it is a monolithic thing that signifies monolithically. Coming back to Eve Kosofsky's Sedgwick. So that is what we could call cisgenderism, or I just call it gender fascism. The assumption of cisgender identity. Everybody knows what cisgender means, yeah? So when you're happy to be identified as the gender with this that corresponds to the sex you were assigned at birth. And sometimes it's really in the intersex cases, it's really funny. They sometimes do that with a ruler, you know, everything under one or a half a centimeter is called female, and everything above is called male, and so on. Yeah, because you have intersex conditions, you know, where it's not clear genitally, anatomically, what should you call a person, male or female. And the thing is, I don't understand it. People go around and they say, well, oh, I have a baby, and so on. And the first question is, oh, is it a boy or a girl? And I always want to answer, it can't talk yet, so we don't know. Right, yes. So one important thing of queer is it challenges notions of essentialism, identitarian essentialism. In other words, the idea that aspects of our identity that we perform in Butlerian terms are corresponding to inherent core or essence that is not changing. Which is pretty silly, you know? It's silly biographically because we know we all change. We are quite different than when we were 1 or 5 or 10 or 15 or 20 or 30, 40, 50, yeah, in some of our cases. So instead, what queer says, it's all constructed. Constructed doesn't mean choice in a sense of an absolute choice. This is something that people get wrong all the time. As if identities are absolute choices that we just do and use and take on the whim. But no, they are negotiated according to the degree of emancipated agency that we have against the societal script, which is always coming at us and to a certain degree oppressing us. So it's always a negotiation. So when you can say identity performance, yes, but then people think, well, oh, it's a free choice. It's almost then that people say, well, oh yeah, the fundamentalist Christians are right. Be gay, be trans, this is a choice. And then some Christianities would say it's a sinful choice. Yeah? And then against that, the gay rights lobby and the lesbian rights lobby say, well, no, we are born this way. And the truth is, you know, well, who cares what the truth is in that case? But it is on the subjective level, it is a negotiation. it is not that a queer person, an LGBT person, has a choice in a sense of, all of a sudden I decide to be LGBT because all the cool people are LGBT, you know. No, that's not how it works. It is a negotiation against and contra the societal script, and according to the highest degree of the agency. So performance doesn't mean complete choice. But at the same time, queer theorists would say, well, the whole nature versus nurture discussion, when we talk about homosexuality or also transgender people, so is completely irrelevant. It's the wrong question. It's completely uninteresting. No, because it's usually just utilized for one or the other political goal. So it's not really important why people arrive to a certain set of gender performances parameters. It's just from how can we all agree to create a society that is open and supportive of whatever parameters are expressed and performed. That's the real question. That's not the question for nature versus nurture and all these uninteresting things and these hormone level at pregnancy. So it's a very strongly social constructionist stance. And behind that is actually that what Kinsey already pre-formulated for sexuality and what we also understand about gender as a construction, and even about sex as a biological thing, is that it is a spectrum. And a spectrum, some people think, is also something static. That's a funny thing, something two-dimensional. So what do I mean with spectrum? Okay, so we got rid of the idea that there is only male and female, or only heterosexual and homosexual, right? And then there's a spectrum. Some people could say, well, I'm 80% heterosexual, 20% homosexual, and maybe that would make me bisexual, maybe not. That's still too static. It's two-dimensional still. Because there's a third dimension, and that is the fluidity of our own identitarian development and agency through our, I could almost dare say spiritual, but certainly life journey. Or spiritual journey or our life journey, you know. So there is an element of fluidity. People, very often people, the pendulum for most people falls into a certain percentage of the spectrum, but still the pendulum can shift. And we need to acknowledge that. We need to keep that open. Because what we want is, we don't want the parameters of self-identification and hetero-identification become constrictive to the agentive performance of identity that can and might change biographically, fluidly. So in that sense, queer is very clearly saying, well, no, I'm not on this. So at a certain point of this spectrum of gender and sexuality, it's basically screw the whole pigeonholing. Screw the whole conceptualizations. I'm me. You know? And that might involve all kinds of challenges to the heteronormative script. So I talked about ricochets, I talked about Querköpfe, I talked about the idea of that there is something like gay rights or LGBT rights activism that is not queer activism. I'm not sure I will talk about it, but there's also feminism that is not queer, that's actually anti-queer, trans-exclusionary feminism. So this kind of thing. So that means as queer, as a not so much a denotation of a category, but a cry of defiance, can be applied and self-applied to anybody, regardless of their actual assumed gender and sexual identity and performance at any given time. And that's something really liberating, especially for all these poor people in the middle of the center that creates the margins, you know. The cisgendered heterosexual white males and so able-bodied white males with socioeconomic power and so on, who don't even know that they need liberating. I just repeat all the things again and again, so on the slides. So we'll put them on the presentation, so you can read them again until the message comes home. So what I haven't talked about as well is this whole idea of intersectionality. You know, in size, the center that I'm directing, it's called the Intersectional Center for Inclusion Social Justice, and that has to do that we have to, in all ways, when we talk about identity, social or individual, we have to always talk about more than one parameter. Nobody is just lesbian or white or able-bodied or middle-aged. It has all, everything intersects. There are some queer theorists that do not like to merge too much with intersectional theory, because they feel it is important to keep the focus on gender and sexuality. And intersectional, we could term it intersectional theory, is tending to broaden that up, but then also has the other tendency to strategically assume some sort of overlapping essentialisms. I personally am not so sure. I think the emergence of intersectional theory is a good example of what Butler in 1993 already said, well, queer has probably a sell-by date. It's a sign of success of what queering as the verb means, challenging, resisting, and so on. So the emergence of crip theory, critical race theory, all these kind of things is actually a great sign that queering works. And so I still see a very, very narrow connection between queer and intersectional. But I'm also very much on Spivak's side when it comes to pragmaticism. Now, Gaia T. Spivak is one of the feminist queer thinkers, could also say intersectional thinkers, who are looking at things like gender, sexuality, race, and are thinking about the parameters of activism and solidarity and so on. And one thing that she very rightfully criticizes is what she calls the urban radicals. The urban radicals is an elite form of people from the global south, usually people from the global south, working in elite positions in the global north, for instance, in universities, and using this position to do very, very radical activism for the global south. For ethnic minorities and so on, and intersectionally also. What very often is a little bit problematic with that is that they miss what Spivak calls strategic essentialism. Yes, we know there is no essential thing behind a sexuality and a gender identity or even an ethnicity and race identity. But if we want to advance society, the societal discourse, and that means changing the script that oppresses us all, then we have to, in order to do that, play to a certain extent by the rules that are still assuming these kind of essentialisms. And that means you utilize an essentialism in order to get advancement, policy, legal advancement, societal advancement. And I think that is valuable. And in that sense, I'm supportive of also of LGBT activism versus queer activism. Of course, I'm not against same-sex marriage. you know, it's nice that there are equal rights. My criticism from a queer point of view is simply, do we have the priorities right in our human rights activisms? Do we really need to fight, if we have to choose one activism, do we have to fight for the affluent, white, middle-class gay man to be able to have a wedding in a church and to adopt 1.7 babies? Is that the most urgent thing in the marginalized community? Or is it maybe the trans person of colors who's working as a sex worker and who is struggling an abusive relationship with their pimp and with drugs and with the police harassment and so on? Maybe is that the person we should focus on? Is that the the form of activism where we should need to do something? So I'm never against advancing equal rights. What I'm skeptical is about using strategic essentialism in a way that cements heteronormativity in the form of homonormativity. And here's the big queer criticism. So when we use strategic essentialisms, like Born That Way, I don't believe anybody is born gay or straight or male or female, you know. I'm a radical social constructivist. Honestly, I don't believe it, you know. But okay, it helps some weird people to accept that two men and two women, what they see as two men and two women, have sex with each other, love each other, have a relationship with another. If that's this narrative of born that way helps them, okay, I can live with this strategic essentialism. But I become uneasy when acceptance of gay relationships is bought through a very restrictive discourse of homonormativity. We accept you once you marry, have a monogamous relationship, have the same goals as we expect a heterosexual couple to have, namely to have children and so on, and so nucleonic monogamy, nucleonic family, and so on. And then I would say, well, actually, here the essential the strategic essentialism just helps the people to fit into the oppressive script, rather than undermining the oppressive script. So that's always the question in strategic essentialism that we need to ask ourselves. And I think real queer challenge, personally, I think, has always to be feminist, has always to be intersectional. For me, in my understanding of queer activism is that it is always intersectional and feminist. For me, I cannot separate it. Because that is something that you find in, for instance, trans-exclusionary feminism, that they that actually people are claiming to work against heteropatriarchy, but doing that on the back of actually cementing the marginalization of a very vulnerable group of trans people. And actually the question is, are they really going in against heteropatriarchy, or do they just want to replace heteropatriarchy with hetero or with homomatriarchy, which is very often driven by lesbian feminists, trans-exclusionary lesbian feminists? So what do they actually want? Yeah, they want basically a homomatriarchy, where then the lesbian females are on the top, and the straight males are on the bottom. So, which is, okay, centuries of oppression. I understand this. It's kind of like payback time, but it's not the way forward. It's not the way forward, because you just replace one of the thing with the other. Yeah. So that's my approach to that. Just leave you with this quote. If we take queerness serious, then we understand it as the careful and conscientious struggle for that very identitarian openness which resists the seduction of identity by exclusion. In other words, I perform my identity in a way that I can only exist by excluding other performances of identity from that. And celebrates the whole potential of gender and sexuality, fluidity and diversity. So I talked, well, I could have talked a little bit more into intersectionality. I could have talked about things that I've written about our phallophobia. And I could have talked about... But we have to do that another time. And then I could have talked about that, what I'm thinking about in post-queer ethic, about physical integrity and empowered agency. And when we talk about solidarity and so on. But we don't have time. So I rather have more questions.
This might be a case of me misremembering, but one of the things I've been interested in since some of your lectures as an undergraduate here was, I seem to remember you saying that there was some consistency between queer theory and Buddhism.
Yes.
In terms of conventional ultimate knowledge and the
yep.
Identity being cause of suffering.
Yep.
I wondered if you've done any more work on that or sort of plan to do so, because I'd be very interested in knowing more about this.
Yes, I've indeed, I see strong convergences of fundamental principles of Buddhist philosophy with queer theory. The one thing that interests me especially is that, so there's this, the non-essentialism, there's the fluidity, the always changing, and so on. What is interesting is this Buddhist philosophy is highly ethical without identity, without a fixed essential self. And that is something that I'm really looking for in post-queer ethics. And I think we could look to Buddhism as an example of a philosophy that is completely non-essentialism, but still manages to have a very highly functional ethical value production. It is important for society. Yes, and in some of my publications on queer Buddhism, the last one in the Queer and Paradigm 6 book, I go a little bit into that, further into that. So if you, I can send you that chapter.